Take a stroll through a Japanese city, and you'll come face to face with any number of loanwords from non-Japanese languages. Some you'll experience visually, written out in the katakana phonetic characters often employed for foreign originating words. For example, cafe, cafe, restaurant, restaurant, and the hybrid panya, bakery, stick out among many more. Stores plaster leaflets proclaiming their search for staffu, staff, and advertise their current campaign, sales campaigns. Conversations you happen to overhear contain even more foreign loanwords. People talk about their favorite celebrities using words like aidoru, idols, and tarento, talents. And in the background, two more loanwords ring out, so ubiquitous that you can easily forget their non-native origins. Children call out to their parents using two very standard words, mama and papa. The words we use to refer to our parents are an interesting thing. This is something language learners who have tried their hands at mastering different tongues will doubtless have noticed. Parental nomenclature tends to bear a phonetic resemblance between different languages, including some that are quite unrelated to each other. In fact, mama and papa occur as parental names throughout the world, often by chance or by dint of ease of linguistic development. Japanese, however, is not one such case. Here, these specific words entered rather late, usurping older familial terms. Once ingrained, even the wartime Japanese government's attempt to enforce a ban on foreign words wasn't enough to stop them. Mama and Papa were here to stay. Yokoso to all you mamas and papas out there, and welcome back to Unseen Japan. As always, I'm Noah Oskow, and this fine spring day, I'm happy to bring you a little Japanese linguistic and cultural history. If this seems like your sort of thing, I'd love to have you as a subscriber or to hear from you down in the comments below. Our Patreon is also what allows these videos to get made, so check the link in the description if you'd like to lend some support. Our Patreon supporters recently voted on our next big history video topic, which I'll announce during the end credits. For the time being, tonikaku, let's get back to the history of parental nomenclature in Nihon. So if mama and papa aren't words local to Japan, then just how did children refer to their parents before the terms arrived? Well, the first answer is a pretty obvious one to anyone who speaks modern Japanese. Like languages the world over, there are numerous words in Japanese for parents, running the gamut from both childishness to stately formality. Unlike a language akin to, say, English, Japanese additionally distinguishes between words used for one's own parental figures and those of others. The most basic form of homegrown parental terminology is haha for mommy and chichi for daddy. These two kanji characters form the basis of most of the vast range of terms used for mothers and fathers. Pick up a Japanese textbook and some of the first vocab you'll encounter will include those kanji. Okaasan, mother. Otousan, father. These last two are formal words used not only for one's own parents, but for parents-in-law, as well as other people's parents. Chichi is a compounding of the ancient word chi, which seems to have been an honorific term for a male. Perhaps even earlier, it derived from homonyms meaning blood, soul, or confusingly, breast. Numerous male relations take on the same kanji. Oji, grandfather. Oji, uncle. And more. You can also call your dad oyaji, which combines the characters for parent and father. These days, the word has an affectionate connotation, like pops or old man. Then there's toto, an infantile pronunciation of chichi, from whence comes the more respectful toto-sama. And eventually, the modern otousan you learned from your first year Japanese textbook. There are various theories as to the origin of haha, mommy. One is quite complex, with the word originating from an infantile mispronunciation of more formal samurai-era terms for mother and wife. In this version, both haha and okaasan derive from the archaic okata-sama, mother, wife. Perhaps it's easier to imagine haha came first, leading to the numerous other words for mother. Hawa, kaka, kaka-sama, kaasan, haha-oya. Another common word for one's mom, although perhaps a bit old-fashioned, is ofukuro. Literally, honorable bag. In function, it's the motherly equivalent of oyaji. The word first appeared in the Muromachi period, that's 1336 to 1573, when it was mostly used by daughters when talking to their mothers. These days, it's mostly sons who use it.
おふくろさん。ああ、緊張すんな。ちょっと練習しとこう。大渡部、俺、お前のおふくろさんと結婚するんだ。ああ、言えるかな。
Theories abound as to the term's origin. Perhaps it refers to mother's household management and organizational skills. Perhaps it's a oblique reference to the womb. It may also be a corruption of the word futokoro, meaning the gap between kimono and breast where babies were often swaddled. So we have a good 2,000 years of linguistic evolution for Japan's own parental and maternal terms. In addition to all of the above, there's also uncountable local and archaic words. At different times and places, chichi was read as tete, kazo, kaso, shishi, ate, and more. Haha has been omo, iroha, and amo. There's still semi-archaic formal words like hahaue and chichiue. And this is just discussing Japanese itself. Of course, indigenous vocabularies like the various Ryukyu and Ainu languages have their own words. If you're wondering, Okinawan mom is anma, and in Ainu it can be unu. But then came those pesky Europeans. Now, Japanese is already made up in considerable percentage of Sinitic words of Chinese origin. The first encounter with European languages came in the late 1500s, with early interactions with the Portuguese. Before long, the Dutch became the main point of contact. However, the spread of loanwords through the archipelago was stymied by the Tokugawa shogunate's policy of strict isolation, often called sakoku. This all ended in the early 1850s. U.S. Commodore Matthew Perry's forceful opening of Japan led to a sudden mass interaction with the European world. After the shogunate fell and feudalism was abolished, the new oligarchic leaders of the country rushed headlong towards westernization. European clothing, architecture, political structures, education, all things that we've talked about here on this channel, and all manner of societal changes happened nearly overnight. A few of these elites of the Meiji era, that's 1868 to 1912, even hoped to replace Japanese and make English the official language. Nothing quite so drastic occurred, thankfully, although there was a major standardization of Japanese itself during the Meiji era. Instead, there occurred a natural linguistic exchange, although one heavily weighted towards the borrowing of European words. Mama and Papa came in via the upper echelons of late Meiji society. Until mere decades earlier, traveling abroad had been banned on pain of death. Now, Japanese diplomats and businessmen were traveling the world. The scions of wealthy Japanese families were studying at Oxford and Yale. Japanese children were even being born abroad, and when such families returned, they brought back Mama and Papa, too. Hearing their children use these foreign words delighted many of the high-collar parents of the late Meiji era. A fad ensued, with upper-class parents, the fathers now dressed in Western suits, encouraging their young children to call them by their European monikers. It was in the early Taisho period, that's 1912 to 1926, that the words filtered down to everyday people in Japan. By the early pre-war era, Mama and Papa were firmly ingrained in the Japanese childhood lexicon. Meiji-era aristocrats were generally enthusiastic about just about everything modern. Modern in this context, of course, just means Western. But by the 20th century, however, there were already those for whom the complete upending of older Japanese culture had gone too far. As tensions rose in the late 1920s and the jingoistic 1930s, there was an about-face, and anything too culturally foreign became a target of suspicion. The famed poet Takahama Kyoshi was one who disparaged the foreign takeover of parental names. The word Papa, he said, sounds like it would be sent flying if you blew on it. Parents were still to be respected in those times, with strict levels of formality used between children and their elders. These foreign words sounded weightless, overly friendly. Takahama even engaged in a papa-mama debate in 1917. His interlocutor, the noted feminist poet Yosano Akiko, had other ideas. Japan's syllabary and laws are all transplants from abroad, she said. There's no special reason to detest such words. In 1934, the first attempt to ban the words took place. It came from the highest echelons of the Japanese government. Matsuda Genji, Minister of Education of the Okada cabinet, had been visiting a local elementary school when, to his horror, he discovered the studentry using foreign words to refer to their esteemed parents. He reportedly flew into a rage.
なんということじゃ!
Soon thereafter, he gave a furious speech on the topic. Recently, there has been a fad for the words Papa and Mama. Alas, the filial piety of Japan, known from time immemorial, is in the process of being lost to us. Let us exterminate these words forthwith! The Western press had a field day. Matsuda was already the subject of some ridicule, having compared himself to the esteemed Prince Saionji. He'd even once referred to himself as the Lloyd George of the East. The Times called him Braggart Matsuda, pointing out that perfectly good Japanese today are such words as club, kodak, beefsteak, pronounced beefsteaky, and the whole argot of baseball from foul to home run. Matsuda passed only 2 years on since his push to outlaw mama and papa. The words, however, only came under closer scrutiny as the Pacific War loomed. The Times may have been mocking him for fighting against the linguistic tide, but within a scant few years of Matsuda's death, the jingoism had reached such a fervored pitch that most of the loanwords mentioned were banned. During the war years, anything that smacked of the enemy was to be avoided at all costs. To this day, those English baseball terms mentioned by the Times are in disuse in favor of Japanese creations, all thanks to wartime linguistic self-censorship, otherwise known as kotabagari. However, it's one thing for adults to be cognizant of the social danger a word possesses and avoid its use. For children, such abstractions don't come quite so easily. The imperial government may have wanted a purely Japanese lexicon used by the families of Japan, but a state's reach only goes so far. Mama and Papa survived the war and are still with us in Japan to this day. As an Asahi Shimbun article put it in 2004, the word spread all the more during the post-war years. These days, it would appear that even the Crown Prince's own family has joined the Papa faction. And that, kids, is how Japan met your mama.
Mama, mama, ikai, mama.
Alright, Mina, thanks for tuning in yet again. Sorry for the lack of videos over the past bit, the big Minobe video took a bit out of me. Plus, I've been running all over Japan and even to India for a while. Want to give a shout out to Illuminabi for doing audio editing for this one, just like the Minobe video. He's becoming not only UJ's on-call artist, but also our semi-official audio editor. I'm very thankful. So I wanted to get this shorter video out between bigger history essays, including the one our Patreon supporters voted for, which is, drumroll please, How the Samurai Saw the Civil War. Think this should be a pretty interesting topic to dive into. If you enjoyed this episode and want to see more, subscribe, give us a like, and maybe join our Patreon to help ensure that Unseen Japan can keep on keeping on. Major thanks to all our supporters, and for all you here in Japan, hope you enjoy the upcoming sakura season. Maybe I'll even see you at a hanami somewhere. Until next time, mata ne.
I can't say I'm too well versed in the
papa.
I'm more of a
mama
type of guy. Good to know!